Well, welcome to the MAM Journals. Today I'm going to be talking about the Royal Enfield big bore conversion, which has been carried out by King's Two Wheel Centre near Oxford. And I've been following this project with interest. As some of you may know by watching the first two episodes, which I put on the links below, is something that I've been thinking about and doing with my bike, and I'll touch on that in a moment. But the primary part of this video will be about what have they done to the engine, what development work's taken place on that. Then we'll be talking about suspension modifications. Thirdly, we'll be going on to the other cosmetic areas that have been put on the bike. The fourth section, I'll be talking about what it's like to ride, and I've got some GoPro footage, although you know, I question the value of that sometimes, but I think at least it'd be something to talk over as to how I felt it was when it was riding it. And finally, I'll be talking about my personal plans as a result of having spent a week with this bike, which has been great fun, and I'm very grateful to Craig and Steve for lending me the bike. I think it probably makes sense to start as to go to that one as to what my objectives are. I bought this last year and actually I like it. Just so we need to start from that premise. I think it's a great bike. It's what I wanted. Actually, I've got lots, you can see in the background there, I've got lots of different bikes and lots of sportier bikes than this. But I wanted a twin upright position that I could use for certain types of riding that I do when I'm in a sort of slightly gentler mode. And just enjoying driving around the countryside. But I quickly found riding it that actually I like the idea of it. I do like twin power. And I think the geometry on this bike is very nicely sorted. A lot of people don't know that actually. The Royal Enfield have got a very good design and research centre here in the UK. And they also bought Harris Performance as part of their business now, so they've certainly got the capability and have delivered in terms of the chassis and geometry. It's a good bike, and but as I rode around, I did find myself thinking it's a long way off really, or some of the other bikes on like, and whilst I'm not looking to turn it into a sports bike, I wonder if I could make it sportier. It'd be quite nice to do slightly less following and more intercepting. So that was my brief to myself when I thought about doing that, and that ties us back nicely into why I've taken such a keen interest in this bike and watched the project as it's gone. So let's start, and I'll talk you through what they've actually done with the engine. Right, when you put a project like this together, there tends to be a sort of project architect, and then you assemble a team to help you actually deliver what you've got in your mind, and certainly with this one, this is Craig is the architect. He worked out what he wanted, and then he worked out how to do it. So let's start with the logical place at the beginning. The first thing you need to do to improve performance is you need to make sure you've got the right amount of air going in. Air filters obviously underneath the seat there. The standard box stroke mechanism is fairly restrictive. So they've changed that, and they've also put a K&N in. The cost of that is circa £70. And just to help people, the prices that I quote include VAT but exclude labour, because it depends on who you get to do it, and whether you do any of it yourself. So you then, having got the air in, you then need to they put the big ball kit on. This is the S&S big ball kit, which is £799 and 865cc. They put the S&S cam in it, which is £220. What it does is increases the duration and slightly increases how open the valves are. And so having got the air in, got the fuel in and set light to it, you then of course need to get it all back out again. And at that point, Craig engaged Viv Cowley, who is a very well-regarded local engineer, who probably be embarrassed to hear me say it, but he's actually a genius. He does one-off projects for people around the world, and some of the engineering is staggering in its complexity and ingenuity. And he can do things like this in his sleep, but fortunately, he gets very passionate about projects, and he's a pleasure to spend time with, so he loves doing things like this. So what he's done here is actually he's put a 40, he's gas flowed the head. He then put 48 millimeter downpipes on it, and 16 gauge, and for the anorex amongst us, 304 stainless, and that means that the internal diameter is 36.4. Now, if you compare that to the standard pipes, they look actually, at a glance, very similar diameter, but the standard ones have got double skins in them, so they're actually 32 mil internal diameter. So you can see that that significantly increases the flow. The cost of Viv's work on that is circa £400. And what he's actually done with this particular bike is they put on the S&S mufflers. There's one on either side, and they're £599. And you can see with this particular one, they formed it so that they can create a bracket where the pillion used to mount. But clearly, if somebody took the view, well, I want to retain my pillion capability, then they just alter the design. So they've got the air in, they've set light to it, and they've got it out again. The next thing you need to do is obviously make sure that the ECU is sort of setting light to it in the right way, and the timing is all working properly. So that the standard ECU isn't capable of doing that, so that you go and get it remapped. And they used a local expert in that, DWR at Buckingham, and they are... Well, the R stands for racing, which gives you a clue about their sort of level of confidence and the sort of work that they do. And they then map it. You can just, I'll just briefly explain, you can get something called a flash. And that's essentially, somebody works on a bike, gets an idea of what the setting would be. You send in your ECU and they just copy what they've done on previous bikes. But clearly that wasn't appropriate in this particular case, because they wanted to get it sort of bang on, really. And they wanted to make sure they set it up in 1,000 rev increments. And it takes quite a long time to do it. So the cost of that work is circa £400. Right, so what power did it actually deliver? I have to say, I get slightly frustrated with manufacturers and journalists. We talk about brake horsepower, we talk about kilowatt power, we talk about PS, and some people talk about foot pounds, and others talk about Newton meters. For the purpose of this, I'm going to be doing it in brake horsepower and Newton meters. So, as you can see on the graph now, the standard bike, i.e. what the book says, is that it produces 46.8 brake horsepower, and that's my translation from 34.9 kilowatts, at 7250. It also produces 52.3 newton meters of torque at 5150. Now, what they did, and I thought that was a very proper approach, they tested a standard unit, so they were comparing readings from the same dyno and applied in the same way. So what they did is they put a Continental GT, which is exactly the same engine as the Interceptor, which is why it says Continental GT on the top of the graph there, and they got out of it 44.3 horsepower at 6,095 revs, and they got 53.5 newton meters out at 5148, so pretty close in terms of newton meters. And the measurements are slightly different in so much as on the in terms of the power, because they actually measure it at the rear wheel at DWR, which is most people do, whilst obviously the manufacturer's figures are at the crank, because it allows them to quote slightly higher numbers. Right, so what happened when they actually tune this and got it sorted out properly? Well, they found it produced 62.1 horsepower at 6,673 revs. And for me, most impressively, they got 74 newton meters of torque at it at 4,416. Now, anyone who's ridden one of these knows that 4.5 is sort of 12 o'clock on the dial. So for me, that's perfect riding power, i.e. where you want it to be. One of my concerns about tuning is sometimes you can end up increasing power, but you need to have to go and find it all the time, and that sort of takes away from the whole point of a twin, really, which is supposed to have easy accessible power and easy to ride, which is this is achieved. So I think they've done a very good job on that engine work. And now we shall talk on, let's talk about suspension. Right, so I think a logical place to start with the suspension is, what is it actually fitted with as OE? And I think if you, under hypnosis, interviewed one of the engineers who are very capable at Royal Enfielders and said, is that the ideal suspension that you would have put in? I think the answer would probably be no. But of course, they were building a bike to hit a price bracket, and they did it very well. I mean, the bike sells very well in the UK, certainly in the UK, and they're a manufacturer that sells, last time I looked, 865,000 bikes a year. So they're no mugs when it comes to actually working out what market is and how to satisfy it. But they are very basic units in order to hit the price point. There's no adjustment at all on the front there. And the rear, all you've got is preload on the cam there, or as I call it, a camel, camel's hump. In terms of just putting some extra tension in the spring, it's fitted with 41 mil forks as standard. And of course, if you were going to the extremes and thought, well, I'd like really like to, you could actually sort of go and do something silly like that, really, and put some, that's got 45 mil forks on. But to my mind, everyone's got their own opinion, but to my mind, that would sort of take go away from the whole point, which is to look like a 60s bike. It's a retro bike. So I think it's important to try and keep that, I'd say, the geometry and the scale at the front there. So work within the existing parameters. So in terms of riding it, what don't I like about the standard suspension? Well, if I'm honest, although I don't ride particularly fast on it, I ride it slower than my other bikes. I do ride on some pretty bumpy roads, and I've had it bottom out a couple of times on me, and it just really doesn't have the finesse and control of the front end. Once it's got excited, it takes a little while to settle down, which can be interesting. I just didn't do it. I have messed about with the back at the preload on the springs, but if I'm honest, all I managed to do was to get the back to pogo along with the front, which sort of wasn't really what I had in mind. So I have come to the conclusion that I need to sort out some suspension. So then I began to look at some options, but I'll just show you now what the internals of that actually look like, and I'll give you an idea of the options and how they work. Right, so these are the internals of your standard forks, and there are a couple of bits missing, a spacer and a sleeve, but they won't add much to what I'm trying to put across. You can see the end cap there. This is what's known as a progressive spring, i.e. the amount of tension in it alters through the journey. So it's soft initially and then tightens up. The alternative to that, which would be useful when you're thinking about other things, is a linear spring, where all the coils are the same. So therefore the pressure applied is equal throughout the journey. This is a very basic damping rod, so it's with a hole there to let the oil in and out, and some end assemblies on that. That spring, by the way, there is when it bottoms out, obviously it comes down and bottoms you out there. When it bounces back, it hits that spring so it doesn't sort of crash out at the top, is the idea of that. And there are some very basic solutions out there. Some people have just gone for a very simple solution, said, well, I'll just take it all apart and I'll put a spacer in, then I'll put more tension on the spring. To me, that isn't, you know, the suspension is too far away to think that, for me, that something like that would actually solve it much. It will stiffen it up, but it won't actually deal with the lack of finesse over the valving. So I did actually spend quite a lot of time looking at what the various options are and started narrowing it down to two sets, really. There's the YSS systems, which I shall talk about in a second, and there's also the Nitron system, which is fitted to the King's bike. But if we talk about the YSS, I actually got on the internet and started a virtual conversation with a very nice guy there called Paul Messenger, who runs one of the accessory sites for Interceptors. And he was telling me about what the YSS does, and I sort of said, well, is there any chance I can actually find somewhere who's got one fitted so I can ride one? And he very kindly said, well, come and ride mine, which was very generous of him. And he's actually got fitted the YSS kit and what's known as the G-Tops, which is a slightly more advanced rear shock. And the front kit for the YSS essentially changes the spring, so it moves that to one way. They use that damper, but they put a more sophisticated, but still comparatively basic, fluid control unit on the bottom there. So, and that's one way of actually improving the front. And when I rode the bike, when I first got it, I thought, do you know what, that's probably solved the problem. So it is a significant improvement on the standard. But obviously that was prior to me trying the Nitrons. At the rear, they do two sort of sets. So you can either have what's called the Zeds, which haven't got the piggyback reservoir on and have slightly less control. And they've got the G-Tops. So in terms of pricing for those, just to give you a sort of a feel for it really, the cost of those, and I have to say with YSS, I found the pricing on the internet hugely varies, and there are deals available. And certainly if anybody just wants to buy a set of these and quietly go off and fit themselves, then I was, you know, contact Paul, I'm sure he'd be very helpful because he seems to have contacts in that area. But if we just say it's 260 for the front kit, 390 for the Z, and 540 for the G, so basically it's either £650 or £800 to put the YSS system on. But the one that's used on the big bore is of course the Nitron, and we should talk about that. So the Nitron system, as I say, operates within the existing forks, but as you can tell by the fact that I've got all the contents of the original bike, it actually removes all of them, and they put a cartridge in there which has got their own technology in, and it gives you a lot more sophistication and control over what's actually going on. Obviously you can set preload on, and you can do that on both, i.e. the tension in the spring. On this fork you can adjust the compression, and on this fork, if I can get it to show it, you can do the rebound. So that gives you really, it might seem unusual to do them on separate forks, but it is, they operate as a unit, and it's common practice nowadays that they more sophisticated systems do that. And it gives you infinite control really. You can, you know, set it up from anything between rock hard and very soft, but that gives you a lot more flexibility when you're setting up suspension if you want something that does more than one particular job. I think this is a bike you could probably now, with this suspension on, you could probably actually take it on a track day, and also if you want to go on a world tour, set it accordingly. The rear shocks, these are called R1s. Both shock units are £699, so in a full conversion is going to cost you, let's call it £1,400. So what you can see on the rear here, instead of a as I called it, the camel's hump, the cam on there, you've actually got a threaded adjustment, so you've got more control over how much tension you put in the spring, and then you do actually tell them what weight with Nitrons what you're going to ride at, and they'll bespoke what spring rate they want to put in. And you've also got control over both compression and rebound via these knobs here. They are linked, you're not doing them separately, but when you twist that, you are actually doing both, and it's, you know, they set them up so that they are appropriately adjusted. But it is a very nice system, and it gives you a lot more control. And there's no question that it's the most of the ones that I've looked at, it is the most advanced system. And I'm saying it's priced accordingly, really. You like in many things in life, you pay the money and take the choice. Right, so let's talk about some of the styling changes they've made on the bike. Well, styling wise, I think they've done some nice changes to the bike. And if we start at the back there, you can see that they've removed a lot of the, I'm going to call it paraphernalia, which is on the standard bike, which is to my eye a little bit cluttered. You can see that somebody's sort of worked their way through the regulations there and ticked the boxes as they've gone. But I think this is more in keeping with the original sort of 750 Interceptor of the 60s, which I like. They've also lost the extension on the back there. The seat, they've obviously turned it into a solo. I quite like that covering and the way that they've done the stitching. You can get it done in various colours and styles, of course. And they've also changed the bars. Now, I quite like what they've done with the bars here. And because they put a set of bars on them which are slightly more sort of curved back than the originals. And that actually suits me aesthetically and to ride, because one of my many failings as a motorcyclist is occasionally I can find myself getting a bit too straight-armed. And I like the fact that it forces a bend into my arms, which keeps it nice and relaxed through the bends and when I'm enjoying myself. So actually, I think that's very good. But clearly, as a result of doing that, they've lost the indicators. So they had to find a solution for that. And their solution, I think, is quite neat. I'll just turn them on if I can. You can see that they've actually fitted them in the end bars there. They tell me that this solution is MOT legal because it's sufficiently wide, i.e. distance apart, and can be seen from both ends. And certainly I didn't find any trouble with it when I was riding. I do like to give drivers a clue of what I'm doing. So I did, in traffic, I did end up doing a bit of traditional arm waving. But whether or not I needed to or not, I've got no way of telling because I was riding rather than watching behind. But I think they've done a very nice job on the styling. In terms of those the total things I talked there, Craig was saying it's about £500. To do, well, 300 for the seat and a couple of £100 for the other bits that they've done. There is a little bit of other engineering that they've done. You can see they've cut that and welded it just to tidy up a bit, because there's quite a bit of, as I called it earlier, paraphernalia on here that they've put on. But I think it's a nice job. I think to me that looks more like a 60s bike than the original, which in terms of my plans and objectives is what I want it to look like. So I think they've done some very nice things there. But I'll certainly be the first to accept that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. And I'm sure if you spoke to Craig, they could come up with various ideas or something that might suit you, because the idea is of course to personalise the bike so that it's your bike, not just a standard one. Anyway, all good fun, and now we're going to go riding the bike, and I'll give you some feedback as we go. I think the first thing we should probably talk about is the power of the bike. As we've seen on the power graphs, it does significantly increase as a result of the conversion. And you can certainly feel it on the road. And as I touched on, that peak power is really coming in at 4,500 revs. So that's sort of bang on where you want in the middle of the throttle. So it's a very much more responsive bike than the standard bike. And in terms of handling, handling is about confidence and how well you feel the bike will cope with the bumps and undulations. And certainly for me, it transformed the handling of the bike and coped with the rough roads. And you can see the examples here where numerous repairs and damage on the roads. And in particular, I found going through roundabouts which have been damaged by HGVs, where it's broken up, this bike coped much better than the standard units. I would say overall, I'd probably increased my sort of normal speed of travel by between 10 and 15 miles an hour, because it, one, you can get to the power, and two, your confidence when you do it will handle well. One thing the video doesn't show particularly well is the exhaust note, because obviously, as you can tell, the cameras was mounted at the front of the bike away from the exhaust, so you can't actually pick up the tone. And it certainly is much louder than the standard exhaust, but not excessively so in my view, and I think it's got a nice sound to it. And the sound that you can hear is with the baffles in, so clearly for those that want a little bit more music, then that is possible by removing the baffles. But again, all these are personal choices, but it sounds a much more raucous bike than the standard one. Again, as I touched on in the styling upgrades, I like the riding position. It's pretty relaxed, it's nicely upright with a nice bend in your arms, and for me that makes corners much more comfortable, much more relaxing. So, but again, that's a preference size, and of course it depends on your body size as to where you are with it. But I particularly like these bars, and certainly something I should be looking at. There are a couple of issues which have been remained standard on the bike, which people might want to look at and consider themselves when they're doing their own modifications. And the first one of those is probably the clutch. We've kept the clutch standard on this bike, but there is an upgraded clutch if people are finding that that it's not giving them a feel. I certainly didn't have any problem with it, but whether or not it could cope with it long term, I guess only time will tell. But if you want to upgrade the clutch, that is an available option. The brakes are standard on the bike, and you could, of course, spend quite a bit of money upgrading them. My personal feeling was that although it is significantly more performance than the standard bike, it's not a sports bike, it's a sportier bike, and the brakes were perfectly adequate for what I was doing on the road. And I personally would be happy with the standard brakes kept on them, and of course there are various options. You don't just have to majorly redesign the brakes, maybe just putting a different set of pads in might improve them for those that feel that they do need a bit more braking. As I say, they did work for me. You can see these chevrons that you're approaching now. If you want to amuse yourself and you do plan to go in and have a chat with Craig, you might want to ask him if he knows anybody who's actually taken all of those out on any occasion. It might not amuse him, but it would certainly amuse me. Standard tyres, and certainly I found I was riding the bike more confidently than the standard bike, and was certainly getting over a bit further than I would want to attempt on the standard one, although I'm sure there's plenty of riders who ride the standard bikes very aggressively. But I personally found the tyres okay. What they'd be like in the wet, obviously I've never really had experience of that, but certainly I didn't find any dry grip issues. And they seem to be coping with the power very well. Well, here you can see King's two-wheel centre on the right-hand side, and the bike manoeuvres very well at slow speeds. It hasn't changed any of its characteristics in that regard. And here's Craig just checking that I haven't blown up his bike.
Well, firstly, if you've watched this far in the video, thank you. So what am I going to do with my Royal Enfield? One thing I like about motorcyclists is that we're a very diverse group, and whilst we share an interest in bikes, we have very different views about what's right and what isn't. And I know that whatever I say now in terms of the modifications I'm going to do, there'll be some of you watching that will think that's a complete waste of time, and there'll be others that think, well, he should have been more ambitious. I'm not going to worry too much about that. I value the company and the opinion of motorcyclists, but like most of us, I tend to make my own decisions. So my thought process on this has been, well, maybe I should just do incremental improvements. I should perhaps put an air filter on, change the exhaust, possibly put a cam in. But having ridden the 865 big bore kit, I think if I did that, the incremental route, I'd probably always be looking back and thinking, why didn't I just put the big bore on? So I've made the decision that I'm actually going to put the big bore kit on and all the ancillaries to make sure it flows properly. In terms of suspension, I've not yet made a clear decision. I think if you're going to put a big bore kit on it, you do need to upgrade the suspension. It wouldn't make sense not to. But the question is what suspension you put on. The YSS is a good system, but there's no question that the Nitron is a more advanced, more sophisticated system, and you pay accordingly. I am actually putting a set of Nitrons on my Kawasaki Z900RS, and I do like the product, and actually they're fairly local to me here, and I quite like the idea of supporting them as well. But I'll make that decision once the work is underway in the main conversion. So how am I actually going to do it? Well, I suspect like many of us, I'm perfectly capable of doing light modifications, and I can certainly sort out this area here. I could put new handlebars on, I could change the air filter, I could bolt some exhausts on. But when it comes to major work, like an engine, I prefer to take the route where I'm working with somebody who's actually preferably already done the work and has learned from their experience and knowledge, and who will stand by it in the event there's any small teething problems or any issues with the conversion. So I will be going to King's Motorcycles and speaking to Craig and Steve and the team there to ask them to do it. Just to be completely transparent, I have no commercial relationship with them at all. This channel is not commercial in any shape or form. I've known King's for many, many years, and I trust them, and they've always given me good advice, so that's why I will be going that route. I'm sure there's many capable engineers out there who are watching this to say, well, I can do it myself, and if that's the route you choose to go, then obviously that's great. But I know that if you went to King's Motorcycles and spoke to Craig and you were thinking about getting some work done, I'm sure he'd be happy to give you advice as to what is possible, and indeed let you have a ride on the big bore. But my advice would be is if you're not trying to spend any money, you're probably better off not riding the big bore, because it will tempt you. But anyway, if you're watching it because you're just interested in Royal Enfields, or because you are considering it, or just you're interested generally in bikes, then I do hope that you've enjoyed the video. And if you have, then perhaps if you're in a position to do so, depending on what format you're watching this in, if you'd be kind enough to press like, it just gives me some feedback. And make any comments that you wish in the sections below. And you can, of course, subscribe if you are so minded. But whatever you do, what I hope you do is ride safe, keep well.